set in for July today. Michael Agnew is giving me a great hand with trying to figure out and understand different levels of collaborations and maybe tell me about his past experience with collaboration, since he has been part of major collaborative projects as a writer, as a publisher, and editor, and an artist as well.
Yeah.
So, Michael, what's, when he say he's done about, what do you think about collaboration? What's a collaboration for you?
Collaboration is a meeting of minds, a meeting of skills, and a meeting of ideas. I think the best collaborations are when both artists or writer artists, publisher artists get together and have different opinions about life, art, philosophy, the world around us in general. So it's not necessarily two like minds coming together. They actually work better. Collaborations work better when each person is bringing something new to the table. Collaboration is about learning. It's about challenging preconceptions of what you already know and trying to find different ways of resolving ideas visually, but also the creation of conversations.
So in a way, you're telling me that you should be saving for collaborations when you don't know that part, that area of your project.
Yeah.
You should to choose someone that brings that in.
Yes, it's a kind of, you're trying to get to kind of untapped reservoirs of knowledge and skills and ideas, and go into it with an open mind. Initially, I studied as a printmaker, so therefore, when I graduated, I worked at Peacock Visual Arts, Aberdeen. So I worked with a lot of artists in terms of they would come in, and I would be the printmaker facilitating their practice, their learning, their outcomes, which throws up very different ways of working. Sometimes artists can be very fixated on what they want. They can visualise firstly, or they can visualise an instance of what they're looking for. Sometimes artists come in and they don't know what they're looking for. So the process of collaboration was to find out where they wanted to go on that journey. So at all times you're kind of primed to seek out, research, describe new knowledge. You're trying to find things, and you do that through experimentation, a lot of late nights, I seem to remember, and building up a relationship of working methods and histories. So that was my first experience of real collaboration. Although at that time I didn't see it as collaboration. I just saw it as sharing ideas. It was my job to do that. It was my job to kind of facilitate platforms for ideas between both of us. Although you're making prints with artists, they become your prints also. So you take ownership of it. You're not divorced from the work, you're actually bringing things to the work, which is crucial in any journey. Mm-hmm. So histories, conversations, mistakes, actually when you're printing, making mistakes is really good, important aspect. Because it gets you to think about things that you may not consider before. And also, mistakes helps you to kind of go on a journey with an idea. So you can start in one place, go into the process, and before you know it, you're off on a totally different tangent.
So if you think you're in your creative journey, everything has been going so far, so good, probably too far to the end of it, you should question that as well.
Well, you should always stand back. At the end of the day, you always stand back and have a look and consider what's working, what's not working, what different directions you want the collaboration to go on. You're driving it in one hand, but in the other hand, it's driving you,
yeah,
and it's driving the work.
Yeah, and what do you think when there's a lot of people involved in the same project, which was initially your idea, and you seek for help, sharing these experiences, collaborations, what do you think about the authorship of the work?
I think the authorship is something that becomes a grey area. And again, that's exciting as well, in terms of maybe loosening up your kind of faculties to get into the work. So it's not always about, this is my work. It's about, this is our work. So yeah. I don't have any problems with that. I'm very open-ended about it.
You keep thinking a little bit like, it's our work, but it's my idea.
No, I think, interestingly enough, the last major project I did with Doug Cocker is a project that template for that project was with David Blythe. So when I took it to Doug as a collaborator, although we used the same template, within a few weeks we were on to very different tangents, very different things. And the ownership of the idea, it kind of flits between both collaborators or a group of collaborators. I don't hold on to ideas as precious things.
These ideas can develop as well, and they change a lot.
Ideas can develop.
It's the foundation of the project itself.
Yeah, so it's a kind of, one of the most important things about collaboration is you've got to look at how other people's ideas and works can impact on your own practice. So there is an element of things happening through response, through trial and error, through experimentation. But I'm not one of these artists who kind of fastidiously hang on to an idea. I think ideas are quite universal. I think every artist, all artists have similar ideas. It's just how you kind of tease them out and work with them, and then you can become individual or group responses.
Can you talk maybe if you wish, like, to make an example of successful and unsuccessful collaboration?
Yes.
I'll
mention David White. That was one of the most successful collaborations in terms of we made a book and an exhibition about fatherhood, about the coming of fatherhood. Both of us were expecting fathers. And it was a really successful collaboration because after a short while we realised that we were too tied into the idea, and that in essence what we should respond more to was the collage material we had for making the books and the evolution of the books as a kind of jumping or a narrative. So we moved very far away from that initial idea into something that was more esoteric. So I don't see collaboration as, I see collaboration as, it's not like dogma filmmakers. There's not a manifesto and a list of things.
No, there's no.
There's no rules as such. There is a scaffold in terms of the books, in terms of the things that we use. However, it can go in any direction.
Yeah.
And that's what's important is being primed or aware of the kind of different directions.
Yeah. What they're going. Yeah. I wanted to get into that as well. But firstly, did you have any bad experiences with collaboration?
Any bad experiences?
Yeah. Serious, like, that you regret doing it, any
I won't mention any names here, but I've made prints with people in the past that never embodied this whole philosophy I'm talking about, the kind of openness of making, the kind of journey of an idea. Usually it was in my early days when people were really quite rigid about the making of the work, in terms of start to finish. And for me, as a kind of inquisitive person, as someone who likes to kind of dig in and try things, that becomes really frustrating for me.
You don't look at the work from one angle and you stick to it, because it's the most beautiful one, you keep going around it.
Yeah, and not, you know, I think you're talking about beauty and aesthetic, and you know, that's what drives any piece of work for me. Grunge can be an aesthetic, and ugliness can be an aesthetic, but I'm generally involved in trying to make the artifact beautiful and find that kind of journey. So I have had collaborative experiences where it's just been too restrictive, too much of producing a commodity rather than a kind of a beautiful outcome or something that's completely different. I would say it's akin to people jamming in a studio, musically. People just finding each other and finding the right kind of pitch and tempo and tone.
That's an example, actually.
So it's that kind of feel. You're trying.
You feel each other.
Yeah.
Music,
Yeah. You feel each other's kind of histories. The language. The more you do that, the more you start
getting tuned.
You get tuned in. You become really comfortable with ways of working. But the worst or the least enjoyable collaborations have been where it's been too fixed.
Yeah.
The best ones have been where you start off with an idea and it journeys, it goes in different directions, and before you know it, you've produced something that you didn't perceive really at the start. So that's when collaboration becomes really interesting.
Yeah. You go beyond the expectations. You go beyond that prefix, almost prejudicial idea of what you're going to create.
I mean, I think prejudice is a good word. Actually, prejudicial, is actually a good word in trying to describe it. I think that you need to go in with a totally clean plate, an empty head, sometimes, and then fill your head with the experiences of working with someone or a group of people, and then go from there. Another project where I worked, where I curated a show of writers and artists, was really interesting in terms of we had factual writing, we had fictive writing or fiction, and the end point is a publication, an exhibition with a publication, and the publication was just something which I never really perceived until close to the show time. So it was something that came about through working with people who were interested in books and writing. And
probably the work found its context with the show.
Yeah.
And the show.
The work found its context within the space. Yeah. This was a Duff House. This was a Robert Adam Enlightenment kind of romanticised venue. Very classical. And we were showing contemporary art in this classical setting.
Yeah.
But the book, the kind of collaborative book with the writers and the artists, and people like Adam Dant and Andy Cranston and Ian Irvin contributed pieces to this piece of work. And the book lives on. The collaboration lives on where the exhibition has to stop. So from that point of view, it was really good.
The exhibition is the destination.
And the exhibition was actually the book. I've now realised that. Then getting the physical things into the space was fine, but the book becomes the connection.
The book mapping.
Yeah. So that was a very different approach in terms of just working one-to-one. I was basically creator as curator in a strange way, where I was bringing all these people together and trying to make something.
So the creator gets asked for the guidance and delivering it to the curator.
Yeah.
I mean, as a recognition of roles.
Yeah. Well, there's a different
collaborative environment.
And some people just wanted to give work and not contribute anything else. Other people wanted to be so involved in the mix, which I found really exciting. The other thing about designing books or making books is that you get a chance to work with graphic designers, which is fascinating. Like we're doing here, in a sense. Because depending on what the temperament and knowledge and history of the graphic designer, they will help you kind of design books in certain ways. If you say you want to make a 1960s Biba-like catalogue, Yeah. They want to have
the typography,
the software.
With the length of the lines of the period,
yeah. Yeah.
And everything with imagination is very important.
Yeah. I mean, you know, interesting enough, the really promising thing about the project with David Blythe was is that we introduced a chapbook project into the underpass.
Yeah.
So in terms of teaching and learning, it kind of didn't just stop with the book and the exhibition. We actually took it into what we do, our day-to-day kind of teaching, to see how other, and then collaborate with students to see how they respond to bespoke book making.
Okay.
So from that point of view, really, really interesting.
You mentioned earlier on about scaffolds, collaborations.
Uh-huh.
Your multiple shelves and putting like collaborator to respond to a shelf or a shelf. Uh-huh. They kind of collaborations. I wanted to ask you about levels of collaboration, distinguishing them.
Uh-huh.
If they're passive, they're active.
Uh-huh.
Giving them almost, not quantifying them, but
uh-huh.
somehow giving a recognition, like
uh-huh.
a type, a color.
Right. I mean, I think the idea of the, if I'm understanding your question correctly, I think the idea of the scaffold is something that is obviously about a structure. It's obviously
yep.
about a loose structure. And it is about that idea of, some people will be passive, some people will sit back, some people will not be confident, and they will say, well, this seems to be your idea, you kind of run with it. I don't want that.
Mm-hmm.
I want people to actually to bring ideas and debates and nuance
mm-hmm.
to the actual, the scaffold or the
yeah.
structure. But the scaffold's loose, the scaffold can be. The nice thing about that as a starting point is that after a while you can change that, you can change the levels, you can take it apart, you can deconstruct it and then put it back together again
mm-hmm.
to suit the personalities within the collaborations.
Okay.
So there is that idea of some people not wanting to really be very forceful
yeah.
with it. But
right, no, I understand that.
That's what
I totally
I'm
agree
for.
With it. And I think that's the kind of way I operate in
uh-huh.
similar environments,
uh-huh.
like in the media, when I go out there and I when I'm along my journey and I need things to happen.
Yeah.
Perhaps I pick actors.
Yes. Yeah.
Along the way, like
yeah.
people that I've been interviewing about
uh-huh.
football games, about the football passions,
uh-huh.
or people that like surfing,
uh-huh.
driving from their own country, and like probably going to stay in a car.
Uh-huh.
That how do I recognize? How do I
interview.
Kind of know in a way a mighty not to quantify the importance of the collaborations, but to give that kind of collaboration a level,
aye.
A scaffold probably,
aye, aye.
A name, what kind of collaborators are they,
aye.
These ones?
Well, I think you're talking about people who collaborate and don't see it as collaboration possible.
Yeah, they don't know, they don't see it coming.
They don't know, and you know, that can make people, it can make some people edgy, but it can also make people really lucid.
Yeah.
How they talk about things and how they want to express life journeys or ideas or how or what kind of passions they have for their team or for their culture or for themselves. I think it's about keeping people at ease as much
yeah.
as you can with it. Sometimes when you read papers on collaboration or speak to other people about collaborations, they can put too much emphasis on you know this kind of
yeah.
Stage managed process, and I think that's what you're trying not to do. You're trying not
yeah,
to.
You're trying to stick.
You're
that
yes.
kind of sense of discreetness
yeah.
when you go and approach these people.
It's like if you think of someone like Mike Lee, the film director,
mm-hmm.
who will have a kernel of an idea. He will then get the actors together, and for 6 months maybe they will do improvisations. They will learn language. They will get to know each other.
Get themselves in the role of what they're going to play.
And he'll also, if
exploring the reality.
He will make them if they're doing a specific role. If it's a period piece from 1805, the Napoleonic Wars, he will get them to find the correct language for speaking, for instance. So it's totally immersive.
Yeah.
And then he will look.
from the outside and look at these relationships, and then he will build a script around that. So the dialogue and the conversation describes to him in a similar way this idea of improvisation and an idea being formed over time.
So you think those collaborators, these collaborations are passive because people are just there and they get in a way. I don't want to use the word using them to achieve the results. It's like maybe making them aware in a way.
I mean, everybody wants to work, every actor wants to work directly, right? So that's the first thing. So when you get called in, and I've saw actors describe this, when you get called in, you're initially excited by the fact you're working with Mike Lee. But then you know, or you've heard, or you've seen the kind of processes that you use. So it's maybe passive and passive. You know, maybe jumps between the two.
Yeah. There's a different types of passivity in collaborations as well.
So there's different flavors of that, different ways of doing it.
You can become active within being found passive in a collaboration, so then you actually really contribute because you're actually keen to participate to the project. You see the famous director that comes and pick people to the reception to the actual environment as well as you create this project.
Of course.
So people get that kind of sense of being keen.
Yes. Well, a sense of being involved as well. A sense of being taking ownership of the character. And maybe that's what we're talking about here, is how things can be driven with control and lack of control.
Yeah. Once,
my analogy is once you know how to print properly, you can then fuck about with it. You can then change it.
You can afford to.
You know how to make mistakes, or you know how to control experiments. It's almost
that's quite interesting. It's an interesting theory, controlling an experiment.
And control. I mean,
how experimental that is.
In one hand, an experiment is about trying something that you don't really know.
But isn't that, in a way, it's trying to stick in the comfort zone?
Well, it could be construed as that. But once you've got the knowledge, you can then use experimentation to drive ideas in kind of controlled territory.
You can push experimentation because you have kind of a little bit of control to make up or balance up to that.
I mean, it's an oxymoron. That's what it's called in English. The idea of something that contradicts something else, you know. So controlled experiment is a strange way of putting it, but it's actually a really interesting way of putting it for me. Because, you know, I think one of the best prints I ever made was with Ralph Steadman, British illustrator. Worked a lot with Hunter Thompson and did Ivy and Argo. Very famous illustrator. We did a series of etchings on writers, and we did Virginia Woolf, poet, writer, took her own life, very tragic life. But we had the etching plate in the acid tank. It's a steel plate with nitric, and then
you picture the character of the
there was a whole series of writers that he made, but we went to the
pub. I've seen one of your books, the books that you worked for, you produced with other people, Iona. Similarities to what you described in there.
Well, what we did was we went to the pub and we forgot about the plate. Okay. So when we went back in, we looked at the plate, and what happens with nitric acid is it creates little bubbles on the surface.
Yeah.
And we both looked at it and thought, Christ, let's print it. So we printed it. And it's an absolutely stunning print. It's a print I'm really proud of, because...
Would you all agree with it?
Well,
because it was great work, or someone said, no, this is not...
Well, once I pulled the proof for Ralph, he was like, spot on, because it got through that kind of darkness and the kind of suicidal nature of a piece of paper, maybe, or, you know. So there was almost a real personality to that print, which you couldn't actually plan that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you couldn't legislate for it. There was a chance happening that when we
by accident,
it,
by total accident,
by total yeah. accident. So that's an uncontrolled. That's an uncontrolled experiment. Yeah. It's a happy it's a kind of positive failure,
yeah.
A happy accident. So there's things like that that kind of you learn from, and you think, ooh, how can we use this in the future? And through that whole kind of dialogue, you start to work in many different ways, you know. So I don't want to be in control of anything. I want to kind of bring my knowledge to the making and bring my experience to the making, but how things kind of find themselves will be proven over time.
Mm-hmm. Actually,
I've made a lot of work, my own work, prior to getting into real collaboration as an artist, a sole practitioner, where I would work on paintings that were on board, and I would build them up in layers, so they had a patina and a history to them, and then I would cover them with paint, just white paint, and then I would sand the surface back. So you basically, it's like a Roman fresco. You're kind of revealing what's there.
Yeah.
But I always had the knowledge that whenever I was, every layer I was putting down or every bit of information, it's in the database. It's in that.
Okay, thanks so much. That was very resourceful, and I think it's been a great experience for me to discuss and probably expand my knowledge about this topic. Okay, thank you for your collaboration.
No problem. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Right.
Thank you.
Okay.